Good morning. Hi, welcome. My name is Anindya Ghose. I am a professor of IT and a professor of marketing at NY Stern. I'm also the co-director of the Center for Business Analytics. I'd like to introduce my partner in crime, Mandie Osborne, who is the associate director of the Center for Business Analytics. Yes. She's been the chief architect of the whole program, so that applause is very well deserved. So I'd like to talk a couple of minutes about the center. You all have flyers in front of you that tells you more about the center and what we do. But just to get you started, we are basically in the business of collaborating extensively with companies in a variety of different ways, primarily based on some sort of deep intellectual engagement, such as a research project or an internship project, or a longer-term project. And there's a lot of room for flexibility in terms of personalizing our services and our talent pool for a given company. What you'd see in your flyers is a picture of this kind, which tells you, which gives you a sense for some of the core expertise of our faculty. We've got a lot of bench strength in some of the most cutting-edge phenomena in the space, digital marketing, social media, social networks, and obviously in crowds and open innovation. And we have different levels of membership as well. So if you're interested in exploring more about how your company or you can engage with the Center for Business Analytics, please feel free to let me or Mandy know. And the flyer will also have information on, for example, our email addresses and what's the best way to reach us. A couple of other things before I move on. So in terms of today's event, as you all know, it's titled New Frontiers in Crowdfunding and Crowdsourcing. We are delighted because we've got a great line of speakers, and some of you probably recognize some of the names. And the speakers come from both academia and industry. And in particular, I personally am delighted because we've got a tremendous bench strength at NYU Stern on these topics, and that is reflected in the program. At least five or six speakers are from Stern itself. So if you are on Wi-Fi, the wireless username is CBA. The password is NYU2014CB. At the red sign. Those are the hashtags. I'd also like to thank our sponsor, Magnet Media. Also want to say hi to the folks on Google Hangout. I know a bunch of you guys are online on Google Hangout, so hi guys. And that's our hashtag. How many of you are on Twitter? Okay, so if you're on Twitter, that's our hashtag, #crowds, NYU's turn. Okay. So again, thank you for being here this morning, despite the weather being what it is. So now I want to kick off the first session. I'd like to introduce my esteemed colleague, Professor Arun Sundarajan. Arun is a professor of information operations and management science at NYU. He's one of the world's leading experts on a variety of topics such as social networks, open innovation and sharing economy, and more broadly on the economics of IT and information systems. So Arun is going to have a conversation with the CEO of Kickstarter, Mr. Jens Strickler. So Arun, here you go.
Thanks, Anindya. None of us really know what information operations and management sciences are, but they're sort of very inclusive and they're a good thing. So why don't we just get started? Yancy, why don't you join me? Yancy is the CEO of Kickstarter. We all know one of the co-founders of Kickstarter. We all know who Kickstarter is. And so why don't we just get started? I figured that, so thank you for being here. It's really great to have you join us. I thought we'd start with, there's most of the people here know what Kickstarter is. They know what crowdfunding is, so we don't need to go through the sort of...
It's turning me on, it's all right.
That wasn't in the advance sheet. So we don't really need to sort of explain to people what Kickstarter is, but so I wanted to start the conversation by, I've noticed that a lot of crowdfunding projects work and a lot of them don't. And so, with Kickstarter, it's about 50-50. So if you had to describe the characteristics of a Kickstarter project that, what are the things that make something on Kickstarter work?
Yeah, I mean, I think... I don't think a ton of it, aside from maybe how a project is framed. I don't think a ton of it is on the project page itself. Like, I don't know that you can A/B two project pages and have slightly different copy or things like that, and it would make a huge difference. I think largely what dictates how people respond to it is the humanity behind the project, the way it's shared. A lot of what we try to encourage people to do is to not try to think of the perfect business pitch for what they're doing, but to try to express it in a very personal way, because I think there's a humanity that's pretty core to how Kickstarter works. And okay. You know, you land on a project page and you see a person and a video, and you press play and try to get sense for who they are. So I think there's a lot of that, and I think the project page ends up being this really powerful canvas to share an idea, maybe the most powerful one on the web. Okay. But I think ultimately it's just that the spirit of the person that is what connects the most with people.
Okay, I mean, I've always got the feeling that it's sort of a social process. I mean, we think of this as crowdfunding, right? But, you know, my perception has been that it's really, you know, sort of friend funding, and then, like, you know, the friends sort of bring in the crowd. Does that seem accurate, or, like, you know, does it vary across projects?
It definitely varies across projects. Definitely early on, pretty much all projects were that way. At this point, over the course of 5 years, it's around 6 million people who have backed a Kickstarter project, and like 1.7 million of them have backed more than one. Okay. And at this point, about 63% of the money has come from people returning to Kickstarter on a regular basis. So of the $1 billion, I think $30-40 million has come from returning backers. So there's definitely a network to plug into, but it varies based on category. I mean, I think in games and film and technology and comics, there are huge communities sitting on Kickstarter looking for something cool to be a part of.
Okay.
But every project absolutely starts with your immediate network. I mean, that's who provides the initial validation that you are a trustworthy person, that you know what you're doing. If you even look at the success rates on Kickstarter, I mean, it's 44% of projects are successfully funded. About 11 or 12% of all projects get no funding whatsoever, so not a single backer.
Well,
but those are people who obviously haven't told anyone about it. The system will drive people to you, but
so
you have
sort of
but you have to start. Yeah, but the stat that we've always tracked very closely is, you know, what is the tipping point at which a project is overwhelmingly likely to hit its goal?
Okay.
And projects that raise 20% of its funding goal are eventually successful over 80% of the time. So it's pretty early on in the process that there's sort of this validation of, hey, some chorus of people think this is worth doing. And I think that chorus and that collective decision making is so important on Kickstarter, with the all or nothing model, where ultimately, you know, this is the largest safety mechanism within Kickstarter, is the fact that no money changes hands unless a quorum of people had agreed that it's a good idea. So you're tapping into the wisdom of the crowds, and so there's just this collective decision making that you know unlocks this experience for creators and enables them to do their thing.
Okay, we're in a business school and we're very fond of these 80-20 and 20-80 rules.
Sure.
So
yeah.
Good to see another one. So what's the logic there of the all or nothing model? I mean, wouldn't it be better to give people whatever money was sort of raised for them? I mean, what's the calculus there?
That model makes sense if you're not concerned with accountability.
Okay.
I mean, people are backing projects in the support of creation something and for a reward in exchange. I mean, that's a part of it. And if there's zero accountability for if you've hit your, like, when money transacts, if I give you $50 to help you make $1 million movie and I'm only one of 10 people who gave you $50, what is the legal obligation of that project? And how, as a platform, are you supporting backers and allowing them to have a good experience? For us, the all-or-nothing model was there from the beginning. I mean, when my partner Perry first had the idea for Kickstarter in 2002, it was the all-or-nothing model that he thought about. He wanted to throw a concert in New Orleans and didn't have the means to put it together, but thought if there were just a system where he could propose this idea to the public, and the show would only happen if enough people agreed that it was worth doing, that made sense to him. So the all-or-nothing model was there from the beginning, and we've seen it as just a tremendous safety mechanism for both backers and creators. For backers, because you're only charged if a lot of other people agree, so you're never going to be like the one sucker or something like that.
Yeah.
I mean, that's like the eBay problem, right? And then for creators, you know, you're only obligated to go through with something if you have the money that you need to do it. So I need to imagine being a creator and I'm looking for 50 grand to make something and I get $1,000. That's a really awkward position to be in. What are you expected to do out of that? Yeah. So it's always been at the heart of the system, and we've seen it being, you know, incredibly powerful. I mean, 44% of projects successfully funded. When we had...
Yeah, before I sort we had of launched, casually said, like, you know, half get funded as if it was a low number.
But well, yeah, when we, yeah. you know, before we launched, when we had, like, our models, we had projected a 5% success rate. That's actually closer to what it is on other platforms.
Okay.
But for whatever reason, this is just, it's connected, and that 44% number has been pretty consistent over any 90-day stretch slice of Kickstarter's history.
Okay.
So that was the success rate in the first year, success rate this year. I have no idea what that represents, but for whatever reason, that's been very consistent for the 5 years that we've been
around. And do you guys have, and you mentioned accountability, and like, you know, I can certainly see the logic of sort of this two-way accountability from the all-or-nothing model. Do you, as a platform, do you ever see yourself sort of going beyond that, going one step beyond that, and actually holding the people who are, you know, sort of listing projects on your site to be accountable for actually, because, you know, I could post a project, then, like, you know, raise $1 million, and I have actually done this. I'm not going to tell you, like, you know, and then sort of, like, you know, take off.
Yeah. we do a lot. I mean, yeah. once backers have supported a project and the creator has their funds and they're off doing their thing, at that point, there's a very limited number of actions that can be taken. Before a project is live, there's a lot that's done. We have a lot of algorithmic tools. We have some algorithms that siphon off projects that seem to have a higher risk propensity. Okay. We give them a closer look. And, you know, we are active governors of our platform. We feel very strong about our track record. However, there will never be 100% success rate.
Yeah.
There will never be 100% success rate. If there were, I would think that the system wasn't doing its job right. Okay. I mean, Kickstarter is funding the future. It is funding very futuristic things,
yeah.
a lot of leading-edge culture, and so some things aren't going to work out. And so we as a system, you know, it is our job to make backers very aware of that.
Okay,
and to be clear that that's how the system will work.
Yeah, and in some sense, it's not that different from other funding mechanisms for the projects of the kind that are funded on Kickstarter, right? I mean, there is no guarantee that, you know, even an early stage company will succeed. There's no guarantee that, like, you know, you raise money to build a theater in your neighborhood that'll succeed.
I mean, this is something that you as a business school professor understand.
Yeah.
But for the general public, for someone who has never been a part of, you know, a speculative financial exchange before, there's not that awareness. And there's also a strong expectation. And certainly you could look at any project, you'll see a creator presenting the blue sky vision of what's going to happen.
Yeah.
Because who doesn't think that way? This is why we require risks and challenges to be listed on every project. We're at least forcing you to think about, well, what are going to be the hard parts of this?
Yeah.
What are the things that could go wrong? And really trying to balance the system. If you have a system that's balanced too much in favor of backers or creators, one or the other, I think over the long term that's not going to play out very well.
Yeah.
And I think that most marketplaces that are biased more towards customers rather than sellers tend to do better, just in that you can attract the network effects and the chorus of people who are there looking for things to be a part of.
So in this scenario, the customers are the people?
Are the backers.
Are the
yeah.
backers. Okay.
Yeah, so we think a lot about just that balance between the two sides. And I think any good system, any system with integrity, is thinking constantly about what that balance is between the two sides of the transaction.
All right. So, you know, a lot of us have been hearing about Oculus. Mm-hmm. And, I mean, for those of you who don't know, it raised about $2.5 million on Kickstarter a couple of years ago. It was then followed by sort of more than $90 million in venture funding, got sold to Facebook for over $2 billion. I think there was some... there was some pushback from some of the early funders on Kickstarter who felt that, like, you know, because when you give something to Kickstarter, it's a gift, that, like, you know, perhaps there could have been a mechanism for them to sort of share in the spoils or share in the rewards. And, you know, I know many of us have talked about this. I mean, like, you know, Anindya and Gord and others sort of have done extensive research on crowdfunding and have sort of, you know, visibly commented on this. But, you know, what was the feeling within Kickstarter when this happened? I mean, you must have been happy on the one hand that there was such a huge success, but how did you feel about the fact that your community didn't get to share in the rewards?
Well, I think...
financial rewards.
Yeah, I mean, I think they shared in significant rewards.
Yeah.
I mean, you know, the funny thing is that the Oculus Kickstarter project had been fulfilled for over a year.
Yeah.
So dev kits had been sent out to backers about a year before, and people were building on them and creating games and experiences with them. You know, I myself was an Oculus backer. I think that was like $25, something like that. I think a T-shirt.
Yeah.
And I backed Oculus for, I think, the same reason most of the 9,000 people did, which is this seems really, really cool.
Yeah.
And I would rather live in a world where Oculus exists than one where it doesn't. And so it was very much in support of the creation of a new piece of tech. And so I've been very happy with my experience as an Oculus backer. And, you know, Oculus is in this really interesting perspective of they've sort of been like the internet's tech all along. Like, there's such a feeling of, like, you know, whether it's the fact that it's created by Palmer Luckey, who's just like this very young guy who's really a visionary, and the way that YouTube is just full of videos of people wearing the Oculus mask and then like freaking out grandma with the Oculus, all this sort of thing. It's like a whole meme on the web. And so it just plays so perfectly into the internet. And so the thing that I really thought about watching Oculus is I thought about being a fan of Nirvana. And, you know, if you bought Nirvana's first 7-inch or if you bought the first record on Sub Pop and then you see them on MTV one day, it's this confusing moment of like, well, wait, that's my band. Okay. Like, what does this say for my identity? You know, it's like it's a complicated thing that you go through. And so that sensation, that feeling of like cultural ownership has like dissipated a fair amount. I mean, you still see it in fan communities on the web, but like Wes Anderson does American Express commercials, the White Stripes do like commercials for everything. No one cares anymore. And you know, and here you see people get worked up in the same type of way about a piece of technology.
Mandie is very happy to hear you mention the White Stripes.
Yeah, here you see the same sort of like this same sort of energy around a piece of technology. And to me, it was really fascinating to watch. But I think that, you know, I think that backers were obviously an important part of getting Oculus off the ground, but this was their company. This is their vision. And for them, I think they want to make Oculus everything that people want it to be.
Okay, so everything you're describing here, it's interesting, because everything you're describing here is sort of the, you know, tapping into the sentiments that are associated with philanthropy rather than with investment.
Mm-hmm.
Right? I mean, like, you know, supporting something that you believe in, like, you know, that feeling of satisfaction that you get from sort of seeing something that you believed in succeed.
Yep.
Your sort of analogies are with sort of like, you know, music rather than with, say, like, you know, sort of tech startup. So it's, you know, I was interested to sort of read repeatedly that you guys have sort of categorically stated that you'll never go into equity crowdfunding, that your model's going to be sort of the philanthropic model rather than the invest in a company model. I mean, what's the logic there? Why not do both?
Well, I think that, I mean, the model, I don't think the model is purely philanthropic.
Yeah.
You know, I think that the Kickstarter system has things in common with philanthropy in that people are contributing out of a sense of an altruism and just a support for something they love. I think that there are similarities to investment and that the money is upfront, so the money is to support the creation of something.
Yeah.
There are also obviously some similarities to commerce and that there are rewards involved, but yet I think it is distinct from all those models, but certainly has some similarities. There's a language from those other models that gets applied to Kickstarter a lot. You know, for us, this goes back to the beginning, and this goes back to what excited us and motivated us from the outset, which is that we live in a world where really, you can only find ideas, you can only find money for ideas that have the potential to make someone else money.
Yeah.
That's what investment's all about. That makes sense. But I think that many of the greatest things in the world are made not to make money. They're made out of passion or just a desire to create something.
Yeah.
And the world, especially any sort of financial model, does not support that.
Yep.
And so we liked the idea of creating a space where art and culture of all kinds could exist just because people wanted it to, and not because it might make some studio exec money or produce a return. Because I think that those sorts of desires are so secondary to the creative process of the creation of art. So for us, you know, we are such a mission-driven company, and our mission is to support, help people bring creative projects to life. And our feeling is that this model that we have, this one that allows projects to thrive on their own merits rather than the potential return they might make for someone else, yep. is going to make a lot more creative things possible than any other model.
I mean, in some sense, it's a fascinating new mechanism for, you know, funding things that are sort of for the collective good, what people have sort of thought of as public goods. And we've always had trouble finding mechanisms to fund these things. And, you know, as sort of we discussed briefly before, I'm always struck by the contrast between the volume of venture capital money and the volume of sort of other giving, you know, $30 billion in venture capital in the U.S., but over $300 billion in sort of other giving, of which I think like 70 or 80% comes from individuals. Foundations give more than venture capitalists. So there's, I mean, there's certainly sort of a bigger market that you're going after. We've got sort of roughly 5 minutes or so left, so seems like a good time to sort of open it up for audience questions. Or we could just keep talking. Yes. Could you just sort of state your name and